So I hope that I've piqued your interest in computational biology a little bit. But I thought before we'd continue on, I'd talk a little bit about what a genome is, what it means to sequence a genome, and give you the biology that you need to know in order to learn more about the computational side of things today. So you probably know that DNA forms this double helix shape that was discovered in 1953, which is essentially this long twisted staircase, and the rails of this staircase are really essentially a phosphate deoxyribose backbone. And across the middle, so what forms the rungs, are nucleotides. So half of one rung of DNA is essentially a nucleotide, and the nucleotides pair up. So there are four possible choices for the nucleic acid at this nucleotide. We think of this as AC, GNT, or adenine, cytosine, guanine, and thymine. And the order of these letters is what determines your genetics. Okay, so the key point is that A always bonds with T, so and that C always bonds with G. So when a computational person looks at this problem, they say, well, I know the A here, I know I get a T for free here, so I don't need to really take into account this T because I know I'm going to have a T on that side. And if I see, say, a G on this strand, then I know I'm going to have a C on the opposing strand. So I can ignore that half of the DNA and simply figure out what the sequence of nucleotides is along one side of the DNA. And so we call the genome, this nucleotide sequence, read down one side of your DNA. And so we can think about this as just a really long book of A's, C's, G's, and T's, right? Your genome is going to have about 3 billion of these letters. And sequencing the genome is what we mean when we mean reading the genome. Okay, so when you hear about genome sequencing, it means figuring out exactly what this sequence of A's, G's, and T's that makes you a unique individual. The key point, though, is that this DNA is submicroscopic. We could maybe look at it with an electron microscope, but that would be really expensive to do for 3 billion letters. So we can't see it, but how could we possibly read something that we can't see? And the answer to that is really kind of the crux of this, why we're actually going to need a computer to help us out. So if we talk a little bit more about genomes, it turns out that you and I are going to share about 99.9% of our genome. So regardless of how much humans may look different, they're still going to share 99.9% of their genomes, and that 0.1% difference, so in about 3 million locations perhaps, that's going to account for all the known differences between humans. So for example, disease risks, that's in the genome. Height, that's in the genome, and so on. So in a sense, most of the genome is shared, and then you're just looking for tiny regions of variation between individuals. So there are two questions then that we have immediately once we know this, which is, what is the consensus genome of, say, all humans? You know, if we learn what this is, then we know 99.9% essentially of what it means to be human. And then once we know that 99.9%, what's in the 0.1%? What is it that makes you unique? How is it that you fit in to this picture? And what is it that separates you from the typical person? So why we would sequence a species genome would be to, for example, construct a big tree of life and understand the evolutionary relationships between all life forms on the planet. So the first evolutionary tree known to be drawn was in 1837 in Darwin's notebook there on the left. And after almost two centuries, I would say maybe the second most important evolutionary tree that was ever drawn was drawn just in 2016 and published in Nature Biotechnology. And what was so fascinating about this evolutionary tree is that if you look at this, it's divided into the three domains of life. So bacteria are shown in purple, archaea are shown in the kind of peach color, and eukaryotes are shown in green. This is constructed based off of genetic diversity in terms of, you know, all the different genes that organisms have. And if we look at this evolutionary tree, what we see is the eukaryotes are by far the smallest little sliver of this tree. Now, eukaryotes are essentially everything that you can see on the planet, you know, so plants, animals, fungi, etc., along with some things you can't see. So everything that you've ever really like interacted with or seen in the world that's alive is a eukaryote and is an extremely small fraction of this tree of life. By far the most interesting group in the sense of genetic diversity are bacteria. Bacteria can live in oil wells where the temperature is extremely hot, or they can live in other really extreme environments. 90% of the cells in your body are actually bacteria. many of which are there to serve kind of a symbiotic purpose. So bacteria live in a lot of different environments and do a lot of different things and are able to survive in really strange conditions and so on. And so from that perspective, it makes sense almost that they should be genetically the most diverse. Okay, so we might sequence an individual's genome as well because we're entering an era of personalized medicine where for many years you've gone to the doctor and the doctor has prescribed to you medicine or given you a diagnosis that's based off of any patient that that doctor would see that day, essentially. So once we know your genome, we may be able to start tailoring medical treatment to you based on your genome. And we've seen the first example of this really starting to work in 2010, where we saw the first person whose life was actually saved because of genome sequencing. There was a young boy who had had dozens of surgeries. Doctors couldn't figure out what was wrong with him. And finally they said, as a last resort, we'll raise the funds to sequence his genome. And it turned out that they found that he was defective for a gene, so they were able to give him a piece of DNA, essentially, that he was lacking and make him feel a lot better, which is a really landmark example of how knowing the genome can help out. There are other examples of medicines for which some subset of the population responds really, really well to, and another subset of the population responds not at all to. So you don't want to take a medication if you're not going to respond well to it at all, and you may in fact have a whole lot of really bad side effects that happen as a result of taking the medication. It would be much better if doctors knew your genome in advance and were able to predict based off of your genome whether or not that medication was appropriate for you. And this is kind of the era that we're entering. And it's amazing because genome sequencing has not been around for very long. We only knew the double helix in 1953, and no one was able to read DNA at all until the late 1970s with Gilbert and Sanger, who developed sequencing methods independently. This was such a landmark breakthrough in biology that they were immediately awarded the Nobel Prize in Chemistry. Usually they wait maybe 10, 20, even 30 years to give you a Nobel Prize. But the committee decided this was such a landmark, important discovery that Gilbert and Sanger were immediately awarded essentially the Nobel Prize. But the issue is that they could only sequence really very simple organisms like a virus because their sequencing methods were just expensive. So it would have cost about $3 billion at a cost of about $1 per nucleotide in order to sequence a human genome. So this seemed prohibitively expensive. But in 1990, the US government said, it's a cost that we're willing to undertake, and we're going to appoint Francis Collins to head this Human Genome Project with a big federal budget with the aim of sequencing just one human genome. That's gonna give us 99.9% of the genetic identity of humans, so that's a really important thing to do. And they said, take as long as you need, essentially. Now, 7 years later, Craig Venter jumped in and said, I think that the government project is going a little bit too slow. I'm going to bring in a lot of private investment, and we're going to have the same goal and see if we can beat the Human Genome Project to sequencing it. And this actually led to a nice partnership between the Human Genome Project and Celera Genomics, where by 2000, they were able to go to the White House and have this big announcement where they said, we've decoded the Book of Life, and we've completed a draft version of the human genome. So this led to a huge boom in genome sequencing. So we saw many more mammalian genomes throughout the next decade. And then in the past few years, we've really seen the market for sequencing machines take off. Okay, so one company, Illumina, a couple of years ago announced that they had gotten the cost of sequencing one human genome all the way down from $3 billion to $1,000. There had been this steady cost reduction, and it finally achieved $1,000. We saw other examples, for example, like the UK funded genome sequencing for 100,000 of their citizens. They said, it's so important, we're gonna give a huge amount of money to kind of start creating a medical database based off of our citizens. And so that's kind of the near future's hope, which is that maybe the next generation of children will have their genome sequenced as a routine medical procedure so that doctors are able to get a larger and larger database of DNA to start answering questions that become more and more accurate over time as we get more and more genomic data to know about patient responses to drugs, likelihoods of obtaining certain diseases at a certain point in your life so that we can start having more better preventative care and so on. So I hope you see that this is a problem of fundamental human importance for many reasons, for understanding our place within the tree of life, as well as for being able to get to the real genetic bases of disease and find treatments for you that are tailored based on your individual genetic identity.